Well, somewhere around second grade, I remember receiving a bike from my dad. And, you know, neither of my parents were college grads. They worked really hard. Resources were tight. And so my dad couldn't afford to buy me a brand new shiny bike. In fact, he went to a junkyard and he found an old kid's bike and restored it. Like way before that was a hipster cool thing to do, my dad did that. He got this bike, and I remember him spray painting it candy apple red, which was like my favorite color back then as a kid. And he even affixed these little decals, these letters to the bike that spelled my name, A-N-D-Y, Andy, on the bike. And then he gave that bike to me, and I was so pumped. I loved that bike. And every time I rode that bike, I really did feel the love of my father. I felt connected to his love as I rode that bike until the day I rode that bike to my school bike rack. And it was there that I rode it in, and I encountered these kids whose parents had a whole lot more resources. They had shiny new bikes that were awesome. Back then it was Knight Rider. I know any Knight Rider fans. Their bikes looked like, you know, kind of like shaped like Knight Rider. There was discs on them and glowing little lights and stuff. And my bike was a junkyard bike. And I remember in that moment thinking to myself, as these kids made fun of me and my bike, and I even remember them saying, like, you don't even know your name. Your dad had to put your name on your bike. I just remember thinking, someday when I get a bike like their bike, then I'll finally start enjoying my little kid life. You know, someday when I get what they have, when I get what they have someday, then I'll experience joy. Mark Batterson calls this the when-then trap, the when-then trap. And it comes in a dozen of different disguises. When I get into that college, when I pay off my college loans, when I get that job, when I get that promotion, when I get a raise, when I get married, when I have kids, when my kids get out of diapers, when my kids go to college, when my kids are finally out of college and I'm not paying for it, hallelujah, when then. When then. This is this trap that if we're not careful of, we just slip right into the when then trap. It's easy to fall into, especially, I think, right here, right now. There's a bunch of us who are essentially waiting for the stars to magically align, and then we will finally experience joy. When this happens, then I'll finally experience joy. And what I want to celebrate with you as we launch into this new series today, I want you to hear me. You can experience real, God-infused, unshakable joy right here, right now. Not when and then, but right here, right now. And that's good news, because today we need joy more than ever. Jay Kim, one of our teaching pastors, shared some statistics he'd come across from some studies done during this pandemic of how this pandemic has been affecting us as Americans. And according to these studies this past year, 36% of adults communicate, they report having trouble sleeping because of stress and anxiety. I am one of those 36%. There's been nights where I just couldn't go to sleep. There was just too much on my shoulders in ways that I've never experienced before, or I would just wake up way too early, not because I was motivated, but because I was full of anxiety. 36% of adults. Another study says 40% of adults report struggling with anxiety or a depressive disorder over this last year in conjunction with the pandemic. Another study says 56% of those between 18 to 24 have been struggling with depression. In that age group, more than 50% of the folks are experiencing real discouragement, real lack of hope, real lack of joy. And I know it's getting like to be cliche to say it's been a hard year, but these stats really point to it. This has been a difficult year. And now that we're beginning to slowly move into this post-pandemic reality, there's this light at the end of the COVID tunnel. There's a bunch of us, if we're not careful, we'll beginning to slip into this when-then, where we say, finally, when we're out of this, I can finally experience real joy. Finally, all the bad stuff will go away and I'll just experience joy. And the problem with that thinking, if we're real honest, as I've been thinking about that statement, that philosophy, is even in my own life, the pandemic didn't necessarily so much withdraw joy from my life as much as it did reveal a deficit of joy in the first place. The pandemic didn't necessarily rob me of all kinds of joy that I had to begin with as much as it did reveal what was already lacking. But the good news is you can experience unthinkable joy right here, right now. And that's what we're going to dive into over the next 4 weeks together, that joy is possible. It's going to be something we're going to press in together for the next 4 weeks. And I'm just going to invite you, I'm going to challenge you, join me in this pursuit of joy, of letting it get deep down in your very soul. The question I want to invite you to ask yourself today as we launch into this new series is, when it comes to joy, have you fallen anywhere in your life, in your relationships, in your business, in your health, where you say, you know what, when, then, I'll experience joy? Have you fallen into this when-then trap anywhere in your life? A psychologist in the 1990s, I told my kids when I was born, it was, you know, in the 1979, and my son says, you were born in the 1900s? You are old! It's like, man. So now whenever I refer to like the 19, whatever, I hear my son. A psychologist in the 1990s, he popularized a name for this when-then trap. And the term that he came up with and popularized as a psychologist, it's very popular in business and psychology. It's called the hedonic treadmill. The hedonic treadmill, hedonism, pleasure, the hedonic treadmill. And what he discovered is that humans are pleasure machines. We have this code in us, this algorithm where we pursue pleasure at all times. We move from pleasure to pleasure to pleasure. Humans tend to chase sparks, sparks of pleasure, momentary pleasure disguised as joy. And in fact, there's people you'll never meet, places you'll never go, where people are getting together and using their best creativity to disguise joy in these sparks and get you to pay money to enjoy their service, product, or experience. And he calls this the hedonic treadmill. It's this idea that we, because we are hardwired to chase these sparks, we can kind of dangle these in front of people, and then when it no longer really produces any pleasure, I'll go to the next one and the next one, much like a treadmill. You guys have heard of Marie Kondo, and what does she actually ask? You guys remember that show? She has you lay out all your stuff, your Air Jordans, your playing cards, that weird turtleneck from the 90s. And what does she ask you? She says, does that spark joy? Really, it's what she's saying is, does that spark pleasure? And what do you do? If it doesn't spark pleasure, you throw it out. And you go onto this treadmill where you're pursuing pleasure after pleasure after pleasure. And here's my point with all of this. A return to normal, whatever the heck that is going to offer us, and as we're moving into this normal, it's already begun, it's going to offer us new sparks, new momentary moments of pleasure, right? Like, I remember the first time I got to go out and eat with Lindsay, we went to a place in Campbell, and I was like, this poor waiter, I was like, thank you for seating me, this is great, thank you for giving me that menu. You know, thank you for the way you filled my water glass. Thank you, right? It's a momentary spark. It's pleasure. We're going to experience in this new norm a bunch of sparks, dining out with friends, going to movies, concerts, sporting events, hugging loved ones, right? We're going to experience these sparks. But here's the important thing as we learn joy and really experience it. Those sparks aren't joy. They're not joy. God doesn't want you on some simple hedonic treadmill where you're going over and over in this when-then trap. God wants you and me. He wants for us. He's wired us to experience real joy here and now. So what is joy? That's what we're going to try to tackle today. I talked with a pastor down the street. He pastors another church in Almaden. And I'm like, I'm talking on joy. I can't wait. And he goes, whoa. I preached on joy once. And I was like, are you serious? What happened? He goes, it was the most boring message I've ever preached. People just started checking out. And I realized that talking about joy is a lot like kissing. It's more fun to experience joy than it is to study it. So my job today is to very quickly just hit 2 points. That's all I got for you. 2 points. 2 point gridly. Here we go. What is joy? What is joy? First of all, think of it this way. Joy is a person. Joy is a person, meaning joy is not so much a what as it is a who. Joy is a person. It's not a what, it's a who. Joy is more relational than it is emotional. I'm going to bring you to some scripture to share what I'm really trying to say here. Joy is a person. In the Old Testament, the most common word for joy is sama. There's other words, but this word shows up a number of times. And it always conveys some connection between people's well-being and their connection to God, meaning that the location of joy isn't elusive. It's not confusing or secretive for us to figure out where joy is. Joy is a person. Psalm 16:11 says it this way, in your presence, there is a fullness of joy, a Costco-sized box of joy. Come on. Psalm 30:11 says, you turned my wailing into dancing and you removed my sackcloth and clothed me with joy. Sackcloth was clothes you'd wear when you were grieving. And it says, hey, when I stepped into your presence, when I was with you, somehow you turned my grief into joy. Joy is not a what, it's a who. This is really amazing. As we move towards God, we actually experience God-sized, unshakable joy. But it's also as God moves towards us, he exhibits this same joy. It's God's posture towards his people and creation as he moves towards us. Psalm 104 says, may the Lord rejoice in his works. He celebrates over this created world. I like this verse even more. Zephaniah 3:17 says, the Lord your God is in your midst. He's a warrior. Basically, he's fighting on your behalf who gives victory. And he will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love. He will exalt over you with loud singing. As God moves towards you, his disposition is joy. It's celebration. It's song. When I hear that verse, I actually think of every silly rom-com movie where a bunch of people get into a limo. There's that scene where they get in the limo, in the back of the limo. It's a stretch limo. And they're like partying in the back of the limo. And then somebody always like opens the sunroof and they get up and they're like singing at the top of their lungs. That's God. That's God when he gathers with you, with his people, when he moves towards you. He's the guy sticking his head out the top of the limo singing over you. In the New Testament, it gets even cooler than this. In the New Testament, we see that not only do we get to experience God as we move towards him or he moves towards us, but in the New Testament, this miracle happens as we trust in Jesus. God is not just with us, but within us. He gives us his Holy Spirit. And so all of a sudden, a byproduct of God within me is that joy isn't just out here. It's somehow inside of me. Galatians 5:22 says the fruit, the byproduct of God's Holy Spirit in me and you as we trust in Jesus is love and joy and peace and a number of other things. And we see that because joy is not so much a what but a who, that joy is not contingent on our external circumstances. When somebody takes what away from me, or I get more what or less what, but because I always have Christ with me, my joy prevails my circumstances. It overcomes it. Colossians 1:24 says, now I rejoice. This is Paul talking. I rejoice in what I'm suffering for you. Somehow I can have joy even in the midst of suffering. Joy is a person and his name is Jesus. There's temporary sparks that this world will offer, but that's different than the joy of the Lord. The world offers temporary pleasure, but there's the joy of the Lord. The world can't give it to you and the world can't take it from you because it's a right relationship with my Creator, my Father, and my Lord. It's not a what, but a who. Joy is Jesus. This is how Dallas Willard defines joy. He's super smart. He's a spiritual guru that's influenced many preachers and pastors. And let me just read his definition for you. It's long. I'll break it down. And it's going to be our working definition, okay? I'll try to not make it boring here. Joy is not a passing sensation of pleasure. What is that? A spark, right? It's not a passing sensation of pleasure, but a pervasive sense of well-being that is infused with hope, meaning it has a future orientation because of the goodness of God. That's what joy is. And this is the joy that God wants us, you and me, to experience even right here, right now. Joy is not a what, but it's a who. Here's the problem, at least for me, as I was thinking about this. A lot of the time, I don't see God as joyful. I'm going to give an example from some paintings of Jesus over the years. A lot of our caricatures of Jesus look like this. These are different paintings of Jesus. He's solemn, he's Norwegian, which is probably not so true. Long hair, Vidal Sassoon commercial going on there. But he's always somber. He's always serious. He's always suffering. And it's true. Jesus fulfilled this prophet Isaiah's prophecy that there'd be a suffering servant. Jesus knows suffering in a way that we will never have to know. It's true, and so I don't want to minimize that. But when we read the Gospels, we see that not only suffering was a known experience of Jesus, but that Jesus embodied a genuine joy that was a huge, huge part of his character. A guy named Elton Trueblood, a scholar, he wrote this book, The Humor of Christ, the humor of Jesus, and in it, he actually teases out of the Gospels all this culturally embedded humor around these accounts with Jesus in the Gospels. It's really interesting. Like, oh, Jesus cracked jokes. He was funny. Think about this. Kids loved Jesus. If you are just solemn all the time, looking, you know, do kids want to hang out with that? No, kids love Jesus. Why? Because he embodied joy. Think about all the sinners that Jesus was a kid. This is what got him in trouble, was he knew how to party. He knew how to have fun. Why? Because he is joy. And in John, Jesus says, if anyone has seen me, they've seen the Father. This is what the Father is like. Dallas Willard says, undoubtedly, he, God, is the most joyous being in the universe. Let me ask you, is that how you think of your God? He's the most joyous being in the universe. It makes me think of that Dos Equis commercial, you know, meet the most interesting man in the world. So if you want to meet the most interesting man in the world, buy a Dos Equis. But if you want to have God-infused, unshakable joy, then pursue this God of joy. Get to know him. This is how C.S. Lewis says it. If you want to get warm, you must stand near the fire. If you want to be wet, you must get into the water. If you want joy, and he goes on, power, peace, eternal life, you must get close to or even into the thing that has them. They are not some sort of prize which God could, if he chose, just hand out to anyone. If you want more joy, you got to move not towards a what, but a who. Joy is a person. And the second thing today is that joy is a choice. Joy is a choice. Meaning that joy is more volitional than it is emotional. It's more of a choice than a feeling. We often choose joy before we feel joy, okay? And in the midst of loss, in injustice, in pain, it's not the easy choice. It's not always the most obvious choice. But the good news in Christ is that you can choose joy at any time. And I know even as I say it, it's like, there's the preacher saying the thing. And there's a little bit of like, that's trite. And it hasn't worked out exactly. If you knew my past, if you knew my circumstances, if you knew what I was going through right now. And it's true, I might not know, but I know from Scripture and I know from my life that joy is a choice, because I can stop grieving what and I can hold on to who. Joy is in Christ. I have the God of the universe on my side, and no one and nothing can ever take that from me. Joy is a choice to celebrate not just what I have, but who I have in Christ. James says it this way. James 1, verse 2, he says, "Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds." This is really cool. I didn't know this before this study, but count it all joy, that word that we translate, count it all joy, is actually just one word in the Greek. And it's like a mathematical term. My wife's a math major, so babe, this is for you, okay? This is one word that we translate, count it all joy. It's an equation, an algorithm. And what James is saying, basically, is he's saying, do the math. Hey, in the midst of your life, in the midst of the disappointment and the discouragement and the up and the down, you have a choice. You can do the math. You can do a mental spreadsheet. And when you do that work, when you embrace not just what you have, but who you have, we realize that we have Christ, that our past is forgiven, that our present is being redeemed. Right now, God is working on your behalf to redeem every part of your story, and your future is secure. No matter what we face, there's always a net profit. Do the math. Joy is a choice. So as we wrap up, I just want to give you some practical things. Maybe they help you. They helped me as I was studying this. To choose joy, to take a step towards joy. And I hope they'll help you over these 4 weeks as we jump into this series together. How in the world do we choose joy? 3 steps. I want to share a powerful story with you that's actually in the book of Nehemiah. And it's a group of people, a nation, very similar to where we've been as a people. They were exiled. They were in isolation. They've experienced real pain, real loss, fractured relationships, despair. I mean, I think if they could do the surveys, I think 100% of people are, you know, like it was a bad time for them. And in Nehemiah, they're gathered all back together in Jerusalem. And they've gathered, they're seeing people for the first time. Sound familiar, right? I want to give you 3 things that I see coming out of Nehemiah chapter 8 that will help us around joy. The first thing in Nehemiah chapter 8 you see is as they're gathered together, the prophet Ezra starts to read scripture, and all of a sudden this crazy thing happens. The people start to weep. They grieve. They grieve. They lament. And I know this is a weird first step to suggest to you for joy, but it's the only pathway that I know that leads to real God-sized, unshakable joy is to lament, to grieve what's been lost, to grieve the sparks that didn't turn out to be true joy. Karina, a few weeks ago on our staff, our South Hill staff, we had a staff meeting, and I said, "Karina, will you lead it?" And she read some verses, and she led us through a time of lament. We actually took time as a staff to just share, like, hey, this is what I lost over the last year. This is where I hurt professionally, personally. And we cried together. I mean, it was the most crazy and beautiful and wonderful experience to just cry and share with one another. In the book of James, he says, hey, if you have any brokenness, any wounds, any sin, confess that stuff to one another so that you may be healed. There's power when we drag our grief out not only into the presence of one another, but we drag our pain out into the presence of our God, who has a power to do something about it, to know that we're seen and heard and that he's on our behalf. I want to encourage you, this one's going to be unfun, but to find somebody to lament with, to take 5-10 minutes. Karina, how long was that? That was like 30 minutes. It wasn't hard. But the byproduct of that pathway, that time together, was actually true joy. We didn't wallow in it, we didn't stay there, but we grieved. And my concern, as we get back to the new normal, for myself, for you, is that instead of lament, we'll numb out on a bunch of sparks disguised as joy. Right? We'll just Netflix it, we'll get an extra bottle of Merlot, whatever. We're going on 10 more vacations. An invitation I think God has for his people here in Nehemiah and for you and I as we regather is to say, whoa, there's some stuff that we've lost. Find a friend, one that's not going to freak out on you. Find a counselor. Find a pastor. We have a prayer team afterwards. We'd love to pray with you and to just acknowledge it hasn't all been good. And to trade those things over and celebrate who we have. The second thing that we see in Nehemiah chapter 8, after they lament, they're commanded to be still. Some translations will say be silent. The literal word is actually the word we get hush from. And here's how I think it applies to us today. I think joy moves at a certain speed. And that speed is always slow. I'm going to read a quote here from a Japanese theologian. He wrote a book called The 3 Mile an Hour God. It's a really cool observation. 3 Mile an Hour God. And he says, he observes that God has a speed and it's never fast. Our culture, slow is bad, right? My car's slow, that's bad. My kid's slow, uh-oh, right? That checkout line is slow, that's frustrating. My internet is slow. Slow is bad in our culture. Fast is good. And the problem with this is that joy is more than emotion. It's a condition, a state of your heart and my heart. And our heart of joy is formed by a speed, and that speed is slow. Be still. Man, this last year we were forced to be still, and my fear is as soon as I can, I'm going to go be fast again. Can I get an amen? Somebody else feel that? Just crowding your schedule, crowding your kids' schedules, if you have them, your grandkids. I want to caution you, take some time to lament, because that's the pathway to joy. And then understand that this joy that you want so badly and I want so badly, it has a speed, and that speed is slow. So prioritize Sabbath. Prioritize a time in your week where you move slow, where things slow down, where you work out of your rest, where you play out of your rest. Prioritize a time every day, maybe the beginning of your day, where you actually go slow and see if it doesn't help you experience real joy. Put it on your calendar. Lament, be still, and lastly, party. Finally! I'm okay with the lament. Okay, fine, I'll be still. It sounds sucky, but I'll do it. And then he says, party. This is amazing. In Nehemiah chapter 8, he tells the people who are all gathered together, like, hey, you got to party. He even says, drink the sweet drink, as in White Claw. You know, get some White Claw and some cheeseburgers. This is actually a religious festival that they've gathered for called the Feast of Tabernacles, which is a celebration of God's faithfulness to the Israelites' ancestors. It's a time to remember in praise and party God's faithfulness. About what? Well, they were in slavery, and God emancipated them. He moved on their behalf. He redeemed their past. He worked powerfully in their present, and he promised those ancient Israelites a future. And so they're supposed to gather for the Feast of Tabernacles and rehearse this with some White Claws and some cheeseburgers in Jesus' name, right? That's what he says here, party. And this is how he leaves it. Nehemiah 8, verse 10, do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Don't grieve. You've lamented, you've been still. Now it's time to celebrate the joy of the Lord. He's going to be your strength. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Here's what's really, really fascinating. That you, your strength right there, that word, in Hebrew, it's plural. It's y'all's. It's y'all. Meaning, what Nehemiah is saying here is really important for us. Joy is going to be found not in the context of being isolated, but gathering together, prioritizing times like this one. Prioritize a time to lament, prioritize a time to be still, but guys, please prioritize this right here. This is a party. This is a chance for us to rehearse and celebrate and hear and be reminded and to remind one another that our God is faithful. We don't just grieve what's been lost. We celebrate who we have. We know Christ. And because of that, our past has been redeemed. Our present, he is working on our behalf. And our future is secure. And when we gather in this way, we experience joy. More than ever before, prioritize your spiritual friendships, your life groups, the meetups that we're offering to get reconnected and to find one another, and these gatherings right here. They matter. They're the pathway to experiencing true joy. As we wrap up, I want to be sensitive because I'm reading a lot of our prayer requests, and I'm aware that a lot of us are going through stuff. And with Nehemiah's words, I just want to pray a blessing over us, immediate as in today and over these 4 weeks as we move into this series together. So for those of us here today with broken hearts and tired hands, may the joy of the Lord be our strength. For those of us here today with weary minds and anxious thoughts, may the joy of the Lord be our strength. For those of us here today ashamed of our past, maybe even last night, and fearful of our future, may the joy of the Lord be our strength. This matters. Us gathered matters. May the joy of the Lord be our collective strength. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. We're going to continue in worship. David's going to come and up here and lead us in a time of worshipful giving. Would you all give him a round of applause?
Thanks, Andy. All right, we're going to jump in. My name is David Christie. My wife and our three very high-energy kids have been running around this campus for a couple years now, and I also co-lead our men's group. So men, if you are looking for somebody and you've been sitting there thinking, I don't know who to lament with, you're challenging me there. I could think of a numerous amount of guys within this group that we've been able to connect with, whether it's from college age to retirement age. So if you're looking for a group to be able to connect with, we have a group out there for you, men. We meet on Monday nights. And come connect with me or with Andy, and we get you connected. We are in a time of offering here, and that is a joyous time for us at Westgate. Offering for us is a great opportunity for us to give, but it's also an opportunity for somebody else to receive, and somebody's praying out there that they need this gift, and we as a church have the opportunity to give that to them and give them joy back. So pray with me. Dear God, I just thank you so much. For being a part of such a great family as Westgate here. And we just thank you for the opportunity to give what you have given to us. However much or little or as much as our time as we can, God, there are people that are waiting for this, God. And I just thank you for being a part of a church that listens. They listen locally. They listen within our state. They listen within our world to see where we can help and where we can give, God. I just pray that these will bring blessings of joy throughout the world. In your name, amen.
Amen. Thanks, David. All right, a couple quick announcements before we let you go outside and experience some joy. We got some fun things there. Well, really, they're sparks, but they're meant to remind us of joy. But a couple things really quickly. What's the first announcement? Because my mind went mush. There it is. Summer Recharge Conference is coming June 25, 26. That's a Friday night, Saturday morning. We've got some nationally known speakers that are going to come in, and that really the whole thing is to help just sort of recharge us as we get into this new normal, some best practices, those kinds of things. It's going to be cool, and you want to think more TED Talk, meaning short talks, and then chances to be with others. Again, this priority of partying, gathering together, being with one another, and getting a chance around tables to share food and conversation, those sort of things. So if that's not on your radar, please be aware of it, and if you can sign up, you can go to our website right away and do that even today. The second thing is what I mentioned, which is our meetups. And our meetups have officially started. Lindsay and I went out on somebody else's meetup yesterday, and these are just fun ways for our church to reconnect in this post-COVID reality. We did a bike ride, about a, 18-mile bike ride. Lindsay kicked my butt, so there you go. Not keeping track, but there's all kinds of things. It's goat yoga, I think, is Josh is leading that one. And there's other fun things going on. So please, no, not really. Some people are like, who's Josh and what is goat yoga? Don't Google it. Or I don't know, do. Westgate meetups, they're on our website under resources. And there's all kinds of different things. Coffee and fun hangout. Go find one and sign up for it. Prioritize regathering these spiritual friendships and see if your joy quotient doesn't go up. That's all I got for you for announcements. I'm going to invite you to your feet. And after the service, I really mean it. We have an awesome prayer team, people who love you and would love to pray alongside you. Whatever God's doing in your life, they'll be in our lounge. And out in our courtyard, get this, we've got bubbles. We've got something else. And we've got Otter Pops. That's the big one that I'm excited about. Yeah, so please hang out afterwards and eat 3 or 4 or 10 Otter Pops. And we'd love to just catch up with you in our courtyard. As you go from this place, may the joy of the Lord be all's strength. God bless you guys.